She gave me one job and I'm freaking out. Daniel chapter 5, and we're going to start in verse 17 and read down to the end of the chapter. If you will, stand with me in reverence to God's word. Daniel chapter 5, starting in verse 17, says, "Then Daniel answered and said before the king, Let thy gifts be to thyself, and give thy rewards to another. Yet I will read the writing unto the king, and make known to him the interpretation. O thou king, the most high God gave Nebuchadnezzar thy father a kingdom and majesty and glory and honor. And for the majesty that he gave him, all people, nations, and languages trembled and feared before him. Whom he would, he slew, and whom he would, he kept alive, and whom he would, he set up, and whom he would, he put down. But when his heart was lifted up, and his mind hardened in pride, he was deposed from his kingly throne, and they took his glory from him. And he was driven from the sons of men, and his heart was made like the beast, and his dwelling was with the wild asses. They fed him with grass like oxen, and his body was wet with the dew of heaven, till he knew that the Most High God ruled in the kingdom of men, and that he appointeth over it whomsoever he will. And thou, his son, O Belshazzar, hast not humbled thine heart, though thou knewest all this, but hast lifted up thyself against the Lord of heaven, and they have brought the vessels of his house before thee, and thou and thy lords, thy wives, and thy concubines have drunk wine in them, and thou hast praised the gods of silver and of gold and of brass, iron, wood, and stone, which see not, nor hear, nor know. and the God in whose hand thy breath is, and whose are all thy ways, hast thou not glorified? Then was the part of the hand sent from him, and this writing was written. And this is the writing that was written: Mene, Mene, Tekel, up Parsin. This is the interpretation of the thing. Mene, God hath numbered thy kingdom and finished it. Tekel, thou art weighed in the balances and art found wanting. Peres, thy kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and Persians. Then commanded Belshazzar, and they clothed Daniel with scarlet and put a chain of gold about his neck and made a proclamation concerning him that he should be the third ruler in the kingdom. And that night was Belshazzar the king of the Chaldeans slain, and Darius the Median took the kingdom, being about 80 years old. Lord, we thank you this morning for your word. We thank you for what we have already studied, Lord, this morning. We just pray that you'd continue to speak to our hearts the things that you would have for us to understand. Lord, that we might glorify your name, and Lord, that we might lift you up to speak your truth and to be witnesses for you. Lord, forgive us of our sins and where we fail you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The message this morning is weighed in the balances. Weighed in the balances. And here is the son of Nebuchadnezzar. And he is ruling in his stead. And knowing all the things that happened to Nebuchadnezzar, and that how God had turned him basically into an animal in the field. He ate of the grass. He lived out there, and so much that it says that he was wet with the dew of the morning, that his hair had become like feathers. God really did a work on Nebuchadnezzar to the point and time that he came to the conclusion, as it says, that God is God, amen, and only he is the one who brings up and brings down, in his hand is our very breath, it says. In fact, Daniel here speaking to Belshazzar told him that God in whose hand is thy breath, and whose are all thy ways, hast not thou glorified. And so here is Belshazzar, and he's lifting up himself. He's taking the things from the temple that were brought over in the siege of Judah and Jerusalem, and has taken them, and they're drinking out of them and having a grand old party with the things that God has that has been dedicated to God. And he is showing no fear of God. He is showing no reverence for God. And God has had enough. And writes, of course, we all know the story of the handwriting on the wall. In fact, that, you know, is a saying that people even use today when something is about to come to a completion or, you know, be destroyed. You know, they say, well, the handwriting's on the wall, right? This is fixing to be done away with. And so it's a very well-known story in the Bible. And the writing and the meaning of it was that God had numbered his kingdom and finished it. It was over. He was done. He was finished. He said, thou art weighed in the balances and art found wanting. And thy kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. Now, I find this part interesting, is that when this tide of bad news is given to the king, instead of falling down in fear, he thinks that he can appease by giving gifts, right? He tried to give gifts to Daniel in the first part, and Daniel said, keep your gifts, I don't want them, right? Because I guess he was trying to get Daniel to give him some good news, But Daniel could only speak the truth. Amen? Mm-hmm. It's like people want to try to butter us up and try to, you know, get on our good side. And they want us to side with them, right? Mm-hmm. But if we're people of God, we're going to stand on the truth of God's Word no matter what. Amen?
Yeah.
Whether it offends and whether it is bad news to them, it is still the truth of God's Word. And here he dresses him in scarlet and puts a chain about his neck and made a proclamation concerning him that he should be the third ruler in the kingdom. So he's thinking maybe that all this stuff he's doing is going to change God's mind, I guess. Which shows man's ignorance in thinking that they can appease God by doing something of themselves. That they can give some gift or do some grand gesture or keep some law or some work, and that God is going to then accept them. But he found out different, did he? Because it says, "And that night was Belshazzar, the king of the Chaldeans, slain." And so none of that he did reversed what God had said. Listen, the only thing that can save us from the wrath to come is Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Amen. He's the only one. But weighed in the balances. You know, people say when you preach the Word of God to them, well, don't judge me. But the answer is that we are not judging, but we're proclaiming the judgment that has already been made. God did not wait for someone to be born to declare judgment. He declared judgment from the very beginning.
Amen.
He looked down on the man and saw that there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that doeth good. There is none that seeketh after him. He hath concluded all in unbelief. Amen?
Amen.
Thou art weighed in the balances. If you look at 1 Samuel chapter 2, King Belshazzar, he trusted in all of his riches. He trusted in all the things that he had, and none of them could save him. And here in 1 Samuel chapter 2, we find Samuel has been looking for the man who God was going to raise up as king. And starting in verse 1, it says, That's later on. This is the prayer of Hannah for Samuel. I'm getting ahead of myself. Okay, this is the prayer that Hannah made when she was seeking after the Lord for a child. Amen? And that God had blessed her and that she took him to Eli because she had promised the Lord that she was going to give her child to God for his kingdom and glory. And Hannah prayed and said, "My heart rejoiceth in the Lord. Mine horn is exalted in the Lord. My mouth is enlarged over mine enemies, because I rejoice in thy salvation." Amen. The only hope that we have is in his salvation. Yeah. Amen. Not in our own. "There is none holy as the Lord. For there is none beside thee, neither is there any rock like our God. Talk no more so exceeding proudly. Let not arrogancy come out of your mouth. For the Lord is a God of knowledge, and by him actions are weighed. The bows of the mighty men are broken, and they that stumble are girded with strength. They that were full had hired out themselves for bread, and they that were hungry ceased. So that the barren hath borne 7, and she that hath many children is waxed feeble." And that's prophecy right there of the church. Amen. "The Lord killeth and maketh alive. He bringeth down to the grave and bringeth up. The Lord maketh poor and maketh rich. He bringeth low and lifteth up. He raiseth up the poor out of the dust and lifteth up the beggar from the dunghill to set them among princes, and to make them inherit the throne of glory. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and He has set the world upon them.
Yes.
He will keep the feet of His saints, and the wicked shall be silent in darkness. For by strength shall no man prevail. The adversaries of the Lord shall be broken to pieces. Out of heaven shall He thunder upon them. The Lord shall judge the ends of the earth, and He shall give strength unto His king and exalt the horn of His anointed, which is Jesus Christ. Amen.
Yes.
Hannah here speaking of Christ. She says that He will give strength unto His king. Amen. Well, we know from Psalms who His king is. Amen. His son. He said, in whom I am well pleased. This is whom He has exalted. And the only way, and I spoke this in our Sunday school class, talking about how the people during the time of Babel could have gone through what God took and changed their language. And not only that, but it says that He moved them unto the different parts of the earth. How God did that, and they still went to serve their idols and went to do the things of their own imaginations instead of falling on the ground and worshiping God, is because you can't worship God without accepting His Son.
Mm-hmm.
Amen?
Yeah.
Until you accept His salvation, which is Christ, Jesus the Lord, you cannot please Him.
Yeah.
Yes.
Amen? And so the Satan blinds the minds of them who believe not. Believe not what? Believe not Christ.
Right.
Amen. If they believe Christ, then the veil is taken away and Satan cannot blind them.
Yes.
Amen.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord that it is God. He is the one. He's the mighty who gives strength unto the lowly and brings down those who are proud and arrogant. Look at Luke chapter 16. Luke chapter 16. Verses 15 and 17, he says, and he said unto them, ye are they which justify yourselves before men, but God knoweth your hearts. For that which is highly esteemed among men is abomination in the sight of God.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. Says the law and the prophets were until John, since the time the kingdom of God is preached and every man presseth into it. And it is easier for heaven and earth to pass than one tittle of the law to fail.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
You see, what is esteemed before men or among men is abomination to the Lord. Because what is esteemed among men is putting their own efforts before Christ.
Amen.
Putting their own way before Christ. Just as Belshazzar tried to do. Putting his own way of appeasing God before of God's way of appeasing himself.
Right.
Amen. And there's only one way that God is appeased, because the Bible says that Christ, that Jesus is the propitiation.
Amen.
For our sins. That means He's the appeasement for our sins. And there is no other appeasement that men can come up with, even if they try to use the law, which is spiritual. They have failed, because only those who are spiritual can keep that which is spiritual.
Yeah.
And you cannot receive the Spirit of God until you receive His Son, Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
And so, yes, the world, just as Belshazzar, they have been weighed in the balances of God and they have been found wanting.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because God sees the hearts.
Mm-hmm.
Men, they justify themselves before themselves out as the outward appearance and what looks on the outside, as we've been hearing all this morning, right? They look on the outward appearance of things. But we look, as the Bible says, at the things which are not seen. The things which are eternal. Why? Because God knoweth our hearts. He sees very down to the very thought and intent of our hearts.
Yeah.
Back to 1 Samuel chapter 16, and this is where I was wanting to, or speaking of the first time. When Samuel was looking for the man that God had chosen to be king. Samuel chapter 16. Verse 1 says, "And the Lord said unto Samuel, How long wilt thou mourn for Saul, seeing I have rejected him from reigning over Israel? Fill thine horn with oil and go, I will send thee to Jesse, to the Bethlehemite, for I have provided me a king among his sons. And Samuel said, How can I go? If Saul hear it, he will kill me. And the Lord said, Take an heifer with thee, and say, I am come to sacrifice to the Lord. And call Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show thee what thou shalt do. And thou shalt anoint unto me him whom I name unto thee. And Samuel did that which the Lord spake, and came to Bethlehem. And the elders of the town trembled at his coming, and said, Comest thou peaceably? And he said, Peaceably. I am come to sacrifice unto the Lord. Sanctify yourselves, and come with me to the sacrifice. And he sanctified Jesse and his sons, and called them to the sacrifice. And it came to pass, when they were come, that he looked on Eliab, and said, Surely the Lord's anointed is before him. So here's Samuel, and he sees a man, and he says, Surely this has got to be him. I'm sure this was a mighty man, right? Big, strong lad, right? But the Lord said unto Samuel, Look not on his countenance. Don't be looking on the outward appearance, Samuel, right? Or on the height of his stature. Don't look at how tall he is, or how strong he is, or how handsome he is. Because I have refused him, for the Lord seeth not as man seeth.
Right.
For man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart.
Yeah.
This is how God has judged us in the balances. Mm-hmm. Is not on the outward appearance, but what is in the heart.
Amen.
We talked about this morning, in talking, that, you know, the Pharisees, they looked on the cleanliness and as being something of godliness. And when his disciples, Jesus' disciples, began to eat and they hadn't washed their hands, the Pharisees had a fit. Why are they eating without washing hands? Oh, that's terrible. That's a sin. That's just, that's just sorry. And Jesus had to tell them, it's not what goes into the mouth that defiles man, but what comes out, because it comes from the heart. And it is the heart of man that has been found wanting with the Lord. Because the heart is desperately wicked. As the Bible says,
yeah.
Who can know it? So the world, mankind, found wanting. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God.
Yeah.
Psalm chapter 51. Psalm chapter 51 and verses 5 and 6. Well, let's read verse 4. He says, Against thee, and thee only, have I sinned, and done this evil in thy sight, that thou mightest be justified when thou speakest, and be clear when thou judgest. Behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, thou desirest truth in the inward parts, and in the hidden part thou shalt make me to know wisdom.
Amen.
In sin were we shapen. In sin were we conceived. We were born sinners.
Yeah.
We were born unclean. And it's against God and Him alone that we are sinners.
Amen.
That we have come short of His glory.
Mm-hmm.
Which is the very meaning of sin itself in the Bible. Sin means to miss the mark.
Mm-hmm.
And every person born into this world has already from birth missed the mark.
Amen.
Matthew chapter 26. Matthew chapter 26, verses 24 through 26. The Son of Man goeth as it is written of Him, but woe unto that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It had been good for that man if he had not been born. Then Judas, which betrayed Him, answered and said, Master, it is I. And He said unto him, Thou hast said. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and brake it and gave it to the disciples and said, Take. I don't think this is the right scripture. Seems like I always get scripture wrong, don't I? Yeah. Yes. Chapter 16. Matthew 16, sorry. I know the culprit. I know I'm always putting in the wrong chapter. It's these fat phones. When I'm typing on my phone, they hit the wrong number. I was supposed to hit 1:6 in my thumbs hit 2:6. So Matthew chapter 16 and verse 24 says, Then said Jesus unto His disciples, If any man will come after Me, let him deny himself, and take up his cross, and follow Me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for My sake shall find it. For what is a man profited, if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul?
Yeah, yeah.
Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul?
Right.
That's the question. The Bible says, though man join hand in hand, they will not go unpunished.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter if the whole world agrees on what's right and wrong. If it is not what God said, they are going to stand wanting before God.
Yeah. Yeah.
They can come to God and say, God, didn't we do all these things in Your name? We casted out devils and all. We did all these good things. And He says, He's going to say, Depart from Me, ye workers of iniquity, for I never knew you.
Yeah. Yeah.
And man can do all that they want to. And that's what they did at the Tower of Babel. They were all joined together and said, let's make us a name and let's build us a tower and we're going to all be one and we're just going to decide for ourselves what is right and what's wrong. And God put a stop to it, right? But isn't that what the world is coming back to today? They're saying, you know what, let's go back to that one world. Let's go back to that one world government. This is why I don't care for Trump as far as his person is concerned. I respect the office. I think God has used him in some ways while he's been president. Just as we read, it is God who lifts up, it's God who casts down. But this is what I'll say, is that they are fighting him so hard because he is against one world government. He is putting America first, and they hate that. Why? Because the liberals in this country, they want a one world government. We heard President Obama go around the world and he said, I'm a citizen of the world. He didn't say, I'm a citizen of America. He said, I'm a citizen of the world.
Yeah.
Why? Because the world is wanting to go back to this one world government. A one world system in which there will be one world leader. And we know who that's going to be.
Satan.
Right?
Yeah.
And why am I saying all this? Why? Because if they gain the whole world and lose their own soul, it is to nothing. It is no profit. And yet this is what they want. They want that one world. They want a world, a utopia. This is that socialist idea. And it's a good idea, okay? It's a good idea that everything's free. Mm-hmm. And that, you know what, there's no rich and no poor, and that we all have the same, right? That's what the church did, right? They mm-hmm. sold everything they had, dispersed among themselves, that everyone had the same things mm-hmm. and the same, you know. That's God's way, amen? But they're doing it themselves instead of doing it how God said to have it done. And that is through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Yeah.
Yet they're trying to do it through world government. And it'll never work. Why? Because they are found wanting. They yeah. can't make socialism work. It will not work in this world. Until Christ comes back.
Amen.
And then it will work, amen? And he'll give to every man according to his deeds, right?
Amen.
Amen. And I say that to say this, but because they think they're gaining the whole world and yet they're losing their own soul.
Amen.
Psalm chapter 12.
Yeah.
They want heaven on earth, but they don't want God's heaven. They want their own. And they themselves, God's. Psalm chapter 12 says, Help, Lord, for the godly man ceaseth. For the faithful fail from among the children of men. They speak vanity, every one with his neighbor. With flattering lips and with a double heart do they speak. Let's tax carbon because of the climate change. I mean, it's just as Jesus said, you can see the sky is red and say a storm is coming, but yet you can't even look to the scriptures and know what's going on. God has foretold was going to happen. Yet they look and see how the weather is getting worse, it seems. You know what? Hurricanes are getting stronger and the rain is getting more. There's more droughts. There's more floods. It's chaos. Well, that's exactly what God said was going to happen.
Amen.
And they think they're going to change it. But he said not one jot or tittle will pass away.
Yeah.
You're not going to change anything.
No.
The only thing you can do is humble yourself. Amen. And seek His face and turn from your wicked ways and let Him deal it.
Amen.
Let God do the work. Amen?
Amen.
But His Word's going to come to pass.
Amen.
But yet they speak vanity, every one with his neighbor, with flattering lips and with a double heart do they speak. The Lord shall cut off all flattering lips and the tongue that speaketh proud things, who have said, with our tongue will we prevail. Boy, if that's not Congress, I don't know what is. That's all they do is move their lips, right? And nothing ever gets done. But they think they're going to change the world by their fair speeches. And the tongue that speaketh proud things. We have said, with our tongue will we prevail, our lips are our own. Who is Lord over us? For the oppression of the poor, for the sighing of the needy, now will I arise, saith the Lord. I will set him in safety from him that puffeth at him. The words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified seven times. Thou shalt keep them, O Lord. Thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever.
Yeah.
The wicked walk on every side when the vilest men are exalted. Amen. That means when man, the person of man, is exalted and not the person of Christ. Whenever the person of men is exalted, things are going to get worse. And that's exactly what's happening.
Yeah.
But God's word will never pass away.
Yeah.
Amen. It is pure. It is tried in a furnace. And God himself will keep his word. He has preserved it from every generation forever.
Yeah.
The humble, only the humble, shall be exalted. You know, Daniel and all that, he was the one exalted, right? Didn't matter who was king, right?
Mm-hmm.
Didn't matter who was king of Babylon, right? And I'm going to tell you what, the whole world is Babylon today, because everyone is lifting up themselves. But it don't matter who's king in the world today, there's only one king we need to know. And that's Christ the King. Amen.
Yeah.
Because if we humble ourselves to Christ the King, as Daniel did, and say to the people here on this, I don't want your gifts. Don't flatter me. I don't want none of that. You can promise me all that you want to promise me. I'm going to stand on the Word of God.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
And if we humble ourselves, then He will exalt us.
Yeah.
Just as He did with Daniel. Because when Darius became king, guess what? God used Daniel just as much in that king administration, if you want to use that, as he did with anyone else.
Mm-hmm.
Philippians chapter 3. Because God, He's still in control. Amen. He raises up and He brings down. Raises up the humble and brings down the prideful. Philippians chapter 3 and verses 7 through 11, he says, But what things were gained to me, those I counted loss for Christ. Yea, doubtless, and I count all things but loss for the excellency of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord. For whom I have suffered the loss of all things, and do count them but dung, that I may win Christ, and be found in Him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith, that I may know Him and the power of His resurrection, and the fellowship of His suffering, being made conformable unto His death, if by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead. Not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend for that which also I am apprehended of Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus.
Yeah.
Amen. Being found in Him, not having mine own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ. The righteousness of God by faith.
Amen.
You see, we were all found wanting. But Christ came to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Amen. Christ came to save sinners, and only in Him, by faith in Him, are we found righteous before God. Justified. Amen. Redeemed. Sanctified. Unto the Master's use. Psalm chapter 17. Psalm chapter 17 and verses 1 through 5, he says, "Hear the right, O Lord. Attend unto my cry. Give ear unto my prayer that goeth not out of feigned lips. Let my sentence come forth from thy presence. Let thine eyes behold the things that are equal. Thou hast proved mine heart. Thou hast visited me in the night. Thou hast tried me and shalt find nothing. I am purposed that my mouth shall not transgress. Concerning the works of men, by the word of thy lips, I have kept me from the paths of the destroyer. Hold up my goings in thy paths, that my footsteps slip not."
Amen.
"By the word of thy lips, I have kept me from the path of the destroyer."
Yeah.
Psalm chapter 37, and we'll be through. Psalm chapter 37 and verse 16. "A little that a righteous man hath is better than the riches of many wicked."
Amen.
Amen.
"For the arms of the wicked shall be broken, but the Lord upholdeth the righteous." "The Lord knoweth the days of the upright, and their inheritance shall be forever." "They shall not be ashamed in the evil time, and in the days of famine they shall be satisfied. But the wicked shall perish, and the enemies of the Lord shall be as the fat of lambs. They shall consume away, or they shall consume into smoke. They shall consume away." Amen. "A little that the righteous man hath is better than the riches of many wicked."
Yeah.
Amen. Weighed in the balances. As long as man is trusting in his own goodness, in his own way, he is found wanting.
Yeah.
But if we will humble ourselves and receive Christ and walk in Him, then we are found righteous. And then, and only then, will we be exalted. Amen. Yeah. Lord, we thank You this morning for Your word. We just pray that You would continue to grow us in faith and in grace. Lord, that we might preach Your truth to the world. Lord, that we might preach Your gospel to every living creature. Lord, teaching and admonishing and Lord, serving You every day. We thank You, Lord, that even though we were found wanting, You sent Your Son to die on the cross for our sins, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. Lord, we thank You for the salvation that we have. We just pray that You would continue to watch over us, continue to bless us, and Lord, continue to increase in us as we decrease. Lord, that You would receive all honor and glory and praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our altar is open for those who want to pray as we sing. Grab your hymn books and turn to hymn number 405. Hymn number 405. Thank you. last, we'll have Brother Clifford and Brother... Well, just Brother Clifford come take up our offering.
Thank you.
right, children.
Thank you.
imagine them crossing that Red Sea. Amen. What a picture. When God saved us, amen. Brought us out of Egypt into His kingdom of light, amen.
Yeah.
All right, hymn number 397. Little is much when God is in it. 397. In